Welcome to the Rionettes Knitting Podcast. My name is Rhiannon, and this is my YouTube channel where I talk mostly about knitting. If you are new here, welcome. If you're a returning viewer, then you know that I'm now coming to you from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. We are recent transplants. We came from Portland, Oregon before this, and I'm actually originally from California, but spent my entire adulthood living in Oregon. So this is a big change for us. And when I say us, I mean my spouse and our cat. Mostly it is a huge change for the cat, who has no idea what happened or why we're here or where we even are. And I say that just by way of introducing myself and my podcast, because I do think that you're going to be seeing some footage of places that we've been visiting because of just kind of the people we are. We're not necessarily going to go out to, you know, every movie theater or public venue, but we are going to go out and get on some trails. So you will probably see some footage of the Seven Bridges Trail and the, I think it's called Oak something Trail. It's so beautiful here. I can't even believe it sometimes. And of course, we're from Oregon, so our standards are high. First off, we're going to be doing a 100 subscriber giveaway. Now, this is a little overdue. I'm at over 100, but I wanted to do a giveaway just to say thank you to everyone who has subscribed to this channel. So not everyone who subscribes also shows that they are a subscriber, and so I have had to essentially limit the giveaway to people that I know about. So I picked, you know, I used a random number generator, and then I went down the list of people, you know, in chronological order of who subscribed, and the winner is Helene Roberts. So Helene, I hope I'm pronouncing that right. I have a prize for you. I want to show that off, but before I show that off, I'm just gonna say the rest of this episode, in addition to the giveaway, will have you know, a little bit of what I'm wearing, finished objects, works in progress, acquisitions, that sort of thing. Like I said, there will be some footage of nature and places we've been to. I have a really special story to share. I do a segment called The Handmaid's Tale, so stay tuned for that. I will talk a little bit about books, but I might actually, we'll see how this goes. I'll watch how long this video is getting, and the books might just be another thing. And just some other kind of like life updates and gossip, I guess. Not gossip, but you know, just chatting, chisme. Okay, so for the 100 subscriber giveaway, it is packaged in this bag, which was from one of Lady Dye Yarns fiber clubs. So Lady Dye Yarns is a dyer, a yarn company that does clubs only. So every club has a number of items from different makers. So some of what's in here, in addition to the bag itself, are from the 2020 Juneteenth Club. And the reason I did that is because I bought this club sort of to support it, I guess, you know, cause it was, I've been kind of curious about what does it mean to buy a club? What comes in it? Right. And that was sort of like the time of year that I had, sort of a gap in my yarn budget, I suppose, to purchase this club. And so, there's no significance about it being Juneteenth in late autumn, but that's what it is. So, so one of the items then is also this bag, which is just a simple tote bag from Zuri. Zuri is a clothing company. I know I've talked about them before, but essentially when you buy a garment, they send you one of these bags, and I don't need this one. So, yeah. Another item is because I'm a tea towel person. It's this Portland, Oregon tea towel. Now, I thought that I would be giving this away from Portland, so it makes a little less sense now. But anyways, it's just a really cute, whimsical tea towel and perfect for regifting if you find that you don't need that. Now here's where we get to some really exciting stuff. So there are two stitch markers in here from a company, a business that is either on pause or maybe done, La Serena Tejera, and I've been a huge fan for a long time of this artist. She makes these beautiful polymer clay stitch markers. This one is a pinata and it's got little like flowers on it. And you know, just like the amount of, what I love about these is that there's a lot of detail without it being like overly fussy, if that makes sense. So they stay cute, you know? This is the knitting avocado. This is like my absolute favorite design, I think. And I think it was, you know, even her most popular. I'm trying to not show the glare, but it's a little avocado and the pit is like a ball yarn that it's knitting. So really cute. So you're going to get those stitch markers. You're going to get this sticker of Bernie Sanders on a ball yarn. This is from Shelly Can. Feel the burr, and doesn't that feel like 100 years ago when that happened, when Bernie wore those mittens and brought, you know, supportive grandpa at the soccer game energy. Another thing, and this is really just, you know, another little piece of my heart, is the Oregon Coast. So this soap is from, what's her name? Optimistic Soap. This is a small woman-owned business in Portland, and she makes the most beautiful, exquisite soaps. And this one, literally, it's like sand and surf, and it smells amazing. And I've kept it wrapped in plastic so that you can, you know, to keep it really fresh. And it's really good stuff. I've used her soaps before, and man, they're good. Okay, and then the final thing that comes in this prize pack is some yarn. So this is the yarn that came with the Juneteenth Club, and it is a 3 big mini skein set. So these are 3 skeins that are meant to be combined in a project. I believe there's a pattern that came with it, but you can find, you know, you can combine them or not, but they are, I believe, merino singles. They're definitely singles, and they definitely have a good amount of drape and luster. And the other thing is, each one of these is 200 grams. So, or I'm sorry, not 200 grams. They're big minis, so I think they're each 50 grams. I think that's what it is. Whereas I think a standard mini skein is like 20 grams or something. These are like 50 grams. So go ahead and weigh it and verify that, I suppose. So Helene, get in touch, and you know, I will get this prize to you. Okay, so just to share what I'm wearing briefly, I am wearing the Botanic Shawl by Stephen West. So I knit this out of a lot of minis and leftovers, and it has become the, I don't know why I'm doing this. It has become like the unexpected hit of this fall, I guess. I didn't think I would get a lot of wear out of it just because it's so big, but if I fold it in half, it's actually just like a reasonable size, you know, to wear just like this as a scarf. And I've been wearing it a lot, and I get a ton of compliments. This pattern, I can't say enough good things about it. I think it gives you a ton of visual impact, and I've had the good fortune to meet some very new knitters recently who are looking, you know, to sort of dabble into, maybe I'll make a shawl or maybe I'll try something. And I really recommend this because it's a simple stitch repeat. It's not hard to make it. It does take a lot of time just because of, again, of its size and the amount of yarn that's in it. But this is a really good pattern that you could really do any color story you wanted to with, and you know, I think you could make it a million different ways. It is a really good stash buster. I think I've fully proved that because people are always asking me, ooh, what yarn did you use? What, you know, what is this gradient? And I said, it's just made it up, you know? But yeah, it's something that would be very easy to do if you were new to knitting. And I love, and we're gonna come back around to this, I love things that bring people in and that that provide people, I suppose, an easy on-ramp into making something very sophisticated that they can feel really proud of. And I really don't like gatekeeping. I don't like it. I don't like making people feel like they have to, you know, be able to do complicated things before they can call themselves a real knitter, or that they have to meet a specific standard. So we will again come back to that again. I don't like gatekeeping, and I love that this is a very, you know, this gives you a ton of visual impact. It gives you a lot of options. It lets you, you know, you can use anything in this. And, you know, the main color that I used is Whole Super Soft. And something I also really love about Stephen West is that he really promotes using that yarn, which is a very affordable yarn. It's about, you know, $3.50. Maybe if you bought it locally and it was, you know, paying for the importing of it and everything, you'd be paying $6 for about 300 yards. So it's very affordable. Anyone can order it from, I think, anywhere off the Holst website, and they ship pretty quickly and pretty reasonably. I love, to me, this represents more than just like, I made this and I'm proud of it. And, you know, it represents so much because I spent very little money on it. I got a lot of impact, and it's kind of the gift that keeps giving. And I love being able to use it as a conversation piece when I meet newer knitters who feel intimidated, who see something like this and go, oh wow, I could never make that. And of course you can. Yes, of course you can. You can totally make that. So I have no finished objects. So that was a finished object several episodes ago, but I just wanted to share it again. And other than that, I'm just wearing a ready-to-wear sweater that, it's one of the few ready-to-wear sweaters I still really love. And I've often thought that, you know, because everything wears out eventually, I will take this sweater with me to a yarn store and try to match the color to a yarn so that I can, replace it in effect, when it's no longer a viable garment. Cause it is, you know, it's a few years old, and I find that a lot of ready to wear stuff, especially if you didn't spend a ton of money on it, you know, has maybe 5 years in it of life in it. If you take good care of it, which I try to take good care of my stuff, but it still, you know, not going to last forever. But I do. Okay. I'm talking really fast. I want to share some works in progress now. So the first work in progress that I have to share is from the Shetland Wool Adventures Journal, Volume 1. I am knitting a pair of mittens because pretty much as soon as I got here to Milwaukee, I realized that my hands are cold and I need to wear mittens a lot more often. And so whereas that was something that I had like one pair of hand knitted mittens before, now I think it's something I'm gonna need multiples of, and I'm gonna need fingerless gloves and mittens, and I'm also gonna need ones that are like full coverage mittens, and I might even knit some gloves with individual fingers. All of that. So the pattern is called Dahmerknin, and I love it because it just sounds like something from Lord of the Rings. And it has this beautiful Norwegian star pattern. So I'm knitting those. They're in, living in a bag that I made, and I have basically finished one mitt. I haven't woven in ends. I'm using a combination of Jameson and Smith 2-ply jumper weight in, I don't know, a turquoisey blue color. I think the colors just have like a number to them. And let me see if I even have that tag that says the number in case people are curious. So, oh, it's teal. Okay, it says teal FC41. So this is a Shetland yarn. It's fingering weight. And by Shetland yarn, what I mean is it's wool from a breed of sheep called Shetland sheep. And Jameson and Smith is one of two big companies that basically buy most of the fleeces in the Shetland Islands and produce Shetland wool. So I'll try this on and I'll show it to you. The contrast color, rather than do a solid like white or natural color, I'm using the Mondeem by Retrosaria in this speckled color. This is a, you know, fingering to sport weight. And I just thought they looked really nice together. So I get a less distinct star, I guess. It's more of a subtle color story, but I think you can, it still has plenty of contrast even where it's blue. There's plenty of contrast. You can see the shape. Now, I want to talk about the things I love about this pattern and then maybe some things that I wish were different. So number one, I love that it has this folded up cuff. I think this is so clever. So you get a colorwork cuff and then inside is ribbing hidden so that they stay firmly in place, but you don't have to just look at ribbing on your wrist. So this was a really cool technique where you knit the cuff and then you basically, you know, because you're knitting in the round, you flip it inside out and you just start knitting back the other way. Now I think I should have done like a wrap and turn, but it doesn't really make a difference here. I do wish there was a mention of that though. The other thing I love is that you actually have different stitch counts for different parts of the mitten. So the ribbing, you reduce stitches for the ribbing, and then you increase pretty dramatically for the hand, which is awesome because obviously your hand is a lot wider than your wrist. And because you're doing color work, I think it has a tendency to pull in anyway. Okay, so those are the things I love about it. What I don't love, I think this thumb starts too low. And this is one of those things that's like, I don't think the designer messed up. I think the designer based it on her own hand probably, and her hand is not my hand. So I kind of wish that I had followed my instincts and started the thumb gusset a little bit higher. It would not have been hard to make that adjustment, but for whatever reason in my mind, it felt really hard in the moment and I didn't want to think about it. And it also is useful now that I've completed it to see, oh yes, I should have gone up maybe 4 or 5 rows. The other thing is that I wish that this would pull in a little more. I think this is a little wide, and I suppose that's so that you can really, you know, stretch your fingers out and really use them fully, but it does sort of feel loose there, right? Like loose around my fingers, and I guess I wish it was a little more snug. I also, I started on a size, US size 1.5 needle, and then I went up to a 2 when I realized that it was just too tight for my color work, but I kept the ribbing on that needle. And so I think I'm gonna go back and redo this ribbing in that, and that will pull it in. The only other thing is, again, this is because her hand is not my hand. I think it's a little too long. I would have liked it to come down or to come to, you know, right about my finger knuckles. What other knuckles are there? And I think it just, think it's just a little off. But it's such a beautiful design. I think the modifications that I want to make and that I need to make, I wouldn't have known what to do if I hadn't actually knitted this, so I'm grateful that I did it. Definitely gonna make more than one pair of these. And I think overall it's a really beautiful pattern. And I think, you know, again, those modifications just have to do with the way that my hand is shaped versus someone else's. So it's nothing wrong with the pattern. I actually think the pattern does, you know, has a lot going on in it, and it is a pretty sophisticated pattern overall. You know, I mean, there's a lot of cool touches that I think make it fit better. So yeah, so I think I will, I might actually just, I hate to think of it, but I might actually just rip back down to the thumb gusset and re-knit that whole upper part. And especially because then I feel like I could take a couple stitches out if I wanted to decrease, or I could just switch back down to a smaller needle when I get up to the very like top portion, even like that top bit of color work. I think if that was sucked in a little, that would be fine. So yeah, that's my first work in progress. Now I'm really curious because this says it takes one ball of each color. And so this yarn comes in 25 gram balls, and this is what's left. I think I used more than half. And I did cake it up because I don't like, you know, when something comes already in a like you can unravel straight from it, but it's not a cake of yarn. I find that when you pull the yarn, it sort of bounces all over and like goes flying everywhere. So I just cake it up anyway, which is extra work that I'm willing to do so that I don't have yarn flying all over. So, okay. Next project. And I'm going to be kind of on an accessories kick for a while because, like I said, the weather here is different, and or the climate is different, and I need lots of little accessories just to keep me warm and functioning. So my next project is the Dipole Beanie, which is a pattern by Chinua Matthews, aka Chin. This is a newer designer, and I really like his aesthetic. I think it's like very cool and modern, but also very wearable, if that makes sense. Like, there's nothing that I've seen him do that I didn't think, like, I want that in my wardrobe. And I'm not a flashy dresser, you know? I don't wear a lot of things that have like a really unusual cut to them or a really, you know, dramatic sort of silhouette. I think I tend to wear pretty basic shapes, and so I love when somebody can incorporate something that's just like a little different, or definitely has like the you can see that it's that person's aesthetic. For example, he has a new pattern coming out, and there's a tester call out. So if you want to knit a sweater, if you want to test knit a sweater, I advise you to check it out. It's very cool. It's based on mud cloth. It's a beautiful design. And I just think it's like one of those things that you don't have to be a super trendy, funky person to wear it, and you could do it in a lot of different colors, and it's just really cool. But it's also, it's like also not ordinary in any sense, you know? So this is also, I think, really cool because it's a ribbed beanie, but it's not, I see a lot of like 2x1, 1x1, maybe even 2x2 ribbed beanies. This is a 5x1 rib, and it has this really great fold up brim that actually folds triple, so you get this really warm band right across your forehead and your ears. And you know, again, like I'm just like realizing I need more hats right now. I need more warmth, and I like things that fit, that are easy, that show off the yarn. And so this is how far I've got so far. And so this is actually going to be the brim, and it will be, I'll try to fold it the way it's going to be folded, but essentially it will be, you know, folded like this. So you won't even see the edge, right? It's not just like a flip up. It's like a tri-fold. And it's, I just think it looks so good, and it's so soft. And it, I think it's just a really great, garment, or, a really great design to showcase a yarn that feels, like something you just want to, like, you know, have on your head, if that makes sense. So this is a yarn I've been sitting on for a while. It's, I would say maybe deep stash. But it's a sport weight yarn. I know it's more merino. I know it's sport weight, and that's kind of all I know about it. I bought it at a destash sale, and I think this was just somebody's experiment in dyeing, maybe a different technique. So here's the information that it came with: organic merino sport, the yardage, and then it says splotches. So I think they wrote splotches to say this is why I'm destashing this. But it was a destash sale that was hosted by Pearl Fiber Arts, so I don't even know who I bought it from, really. Pearl Fiber Arts hosts a Labor Day destash sale every year. If you're in Portland, it's worth checking out. And yeah, and I actually think the splotches are wonderful. I think that's what makes it for me. So it's this all over kind of gray blue, and then it has these like blips of color that to me are just like, yeah, like I don't know if I would be drawn to a yarn that was just a solid, I mean, I love blue, but like just this gray blue with no, you know, no variation, I don't know that I would be drawn to that, to be honest, because it's just kind of, I don't know. But then these, like, you know, I end up getting these kind of like lines of color, which I think are just awesome. So yeah, so I'm knitting that hat. I'm really happy that I'm going to have something that's going to fit well, that's going to really keep my ears warm, because my ears have been cold. And, you know, I think it's going to go with just about everything I own. The next two projects I want to share are, actually one of them's not even a project yet. I just have yarn for it, but, I am going to be teaching two classes at Cream City Yarn, which I'm very excited about. That is my local yarn store, and I reached out to them pretty much as soon as I knew I was moving and said, "Hey, I'd love to talk to you about teaching." I had just got hired to teach at a local yarn store in Forest Grove, Oregon, which is right by Portland. And it was sort of like, when that happened, I felt like validated and excited, and like, it just felt like so amazing to be like, wow, I'm going to be teaching people how to knit. I love teaching. I love knitting. I didn't realize how much I missed teaching. It was very exciting. And I was also very impressed that I, just impressed at myself in a way, because I've only been knitting for like 5.5 years, maybe. I've been knitting since, I think, 2015. So maybe it's 6 years now. But it would be like December of 2015. So it would be just barely, about 6 years. And, you know, I think I feel really good about the fact that I've already advanced my skills to a level where I can teach other people, and, you know, people look at my work and they go, "Oh yeah, you could teach," right? Like, they're not like, "Oh, you're not ready." not that I think people would say that to my face, but, you know, I would hope they would if that's what they were thinking. But, you know, it's felt really good. And then I unfortunately had to move, and so I reached out to this other yarn store that I was excited about and was like, you know, I really miss teaching, and I didn't realize how much I miss teaching and how much I want to do this until I thought it was going to happen. So I'm going to be teaching a intro to cables, basically, to help people build their confidence knitting cables. I'm going to be teaching a class where we knit a cabled hat, and then I'm going to be teaching an intro to lace where we knit a lace cowl. And so I wanted to show what I'm going to be working on there. So I'm working on a shop sample. The pattern is Father Cables by Veronica Job. The yarn is Cumbria from the Fiber Company, and it is an all-over cabled beanie. I've made this one before, so I want to show you the one I made before. I made it in a dark green, but you can definitely still see the cable pattern pretty well in the light. It's got this just really cool, you know, intricate cable pattern, but it's actually not hard, and it doesn't take that long to make. It's just one of those things you have to focus on. And so I feel like, you know, if you've watched for a while, you already know my story, but I started knitting, and I started knitting lace right away. I started knitting with, high-end yarns right away because I didn't know about other stuff, really. I just went to a yarn shop that was in my neighborhood, and I was like, what do you have? What can I make? And lace was kind of my first love, with cables following very soon afterward. I threw myself into textured stitches without anyone ever telling me, you can't do this, you're a beginner, this is too hard. I just saw things I wanted and I went for it. And so, you know, my story with things like color work is that that was the thing that got hyped up in my mind of, it's going to be too hard. But I know that for some people, it's the other way around, and maybe they've knit color work and they've, you know, knit other things, but they feel like lace is going to be hard or cables are going to be hard. And I don't think any of it's hard. And I don't think reading charts is hard. I think you have to pay attention and you have to understand that this is not necessarily TV knitting. If you're like me and you only listen to the TV and you don't really watch it and you don't even listen that well, it could be TV knitting, but generally speaking, this is something where you have to look at a piece of paper, you have to follow instructions, you have to be confident about where the, you know, what stitches you're doing next. So this is the hat. It has an alternating cable cast on, which, let me just say, I impressed myself because I looked at this and was like, okay, this was my one of, you know, I had only been knitting for a couple years when I did this, and I did not think I knew how to do a tubular cast on. So I was like, how did I do a tubular cast on back in 2018 or whatever? Turns out it's an alternating cable cast on, which is a really beautiful, it gives you kind of the same effect, but it's a lot easier to do. So I'm excited to have people do that. And then I'm excited because as soon as you finish that ribbing, which is, there's not a lot of it, you jump right into the cables. So this is the fitted version of the hat. There's also a slouchier version, and it comes in two sizes. So this, I think, is a really awesome pattern to build somebody's confidence with knitting cables, because it looks, you know, obviously very complicated, but it's just repeats of a chart, and it's small, so you're done quickly. And so, yeah, I'm knitting this sample in this sort of heathery lavender gray kind of color, and it's again, it's Cumbria by the Fiber Co. It is, I think, Merino, Massam, and I should have a tag somewhere, but apparently I lost that. It's got mohair in it, so it does have a bit of a halo, and it has different types of wool from different breeds of sheep. So yeah, I'm really excited to be teaching this, and I'm gonna knit this sample to have as a store, you know, in the store, so people can see it before they sign up for the class. And then while I'm teaching, I'm going to be knitting another one of this, so that, you know, I can be doing the techniques and everything at the same time as everyone else. So really excited about that, and I hope that people will, you know, if they've never done cables or if they feel like they could do cables but charts are hard, I highly encourage them to take that class, because I think, you know, if I can just share with you my love for something and help you see how capable you are and how good you are and how you're totally going to rock this, then I will be very happy. The other pattern I'm going to be teaching is going to be a lace cowl. So it's a cowl called Copper Foxes. It's by Casey something. I wish I knew the name, but I'll put it on the screen. And I'm going to be doing it in a yarn that I think is an unsung hero. And, you know, the folks in the shop agreed. It's Arbor by Brooklyn Tweed. It's a DK weight yarn. It's worsted spun. And let's see. It is 100% wool. I can't remember. Okay, it's American Tarhi wool. Tarhi. Anyways, I'm doing this amazing color called Treehouse, which is, can you tell I like green? It's very similar to this, which is actually Solstice Yarns, not Brooklyn Tweed, but yeah, this is like an even deeper, like forest green. And the cool thing about this pattern is, while the lace repeat looks like foxes when you knit it in a copper color, and I think if you flip it upside down, it will look like trees, like a little forest of trees. So I'm all about that. So I'm going to be knitting up a sample in this yarn. And just to give you a sense of how this yarn knits up, these are my mittens that I've been wearing pretty much nonstop since I got here. Every time I leave the house, these are the Skog mitts. So the definition on this yarn is really, really good. It gives you a lot of definition without being super wash, or you know, like yarns that have a blend of something that has a lot of sheen. This actually, I think, sort of absorbs light and is very, it has more of a gentle glow to it, not a, it's definitely like good woolly wool. And it feels like good wool, and it's super warm. And they look a little more worn than they should be because I've been giving them a lot of exercise. So, but I do think that the yarn just shows texture beautifully. I mean, you know, there's no mistaking, you know, the texture. There's garter in there, etc. It's really nice. So I'm looking forward to showing that off too. And again, I think I'm going to knit one version for a sample and then probably knit along with the students in the class so that they can see exactly what I'm doing with my hands, because I think that's an important thing. I know that I learn a lot of things from watching videos that people have made where you can see their hands closely. Now I'm gonna just do a little interlude and show you some footage of where we've been walking and just, you know, some fall scenery in Milwaukee. Okay, so now I want to share a story For my segment, The Handmaid's Tale. If you've watched before, you know that this is hand, M-A-D-E. And I like to just tell the story of a handmade object that has meaning or significance. My original vision for this segment was never that it would be me telling you only about things that I own, but that it would be about handmade things in general. And so I came across this story on Instagram and I have the poster's permission to share it. So I'm really excited to tell you about it. So I saw this post from someone I follow, Vivian, who is La Panatica on Instagram. And I'll link that below. And she posted this just absolutely beautiful series of photos and a description of a crocheted baby dress. So just from the first sentence, it just struck me like what a treasure. She said, when we think of family heirlooms, jewelry, furniture, or family quilt may come to mind. So Vivian shared photos of herself, her daughter, and her granddaughter wearing a crocheted baby dress that her mother made. So this is four generations of a family that have enjoyed this. The first being Vivian's mother, who enjoyed making it and then putting it on her daughter. And then Vivian being able to clothe her own daughter and her granddaughter, which is her daughter's daughter, in this baby dress. And I just thought this was such a good reminder that the things we make sort of take on a life of their own after they leave our hands. I don't know if Vivian's mother ever imagined that this dress that she made in the early 60s would be worn by a baby in 2021. I mean, who would think that, right? Or that it would become such a prized possession. But of course it's special because it was made with love and it was made by your mother. And, you know, if you're a fiber artist, I think that it makes it even, you know, your appreciation of, you know, knitted and crocheted things is even stronger. So of course you're going to keep it around, you know, and you're going to use it because it's meant to be used. So I think this was just such a beautiful story. If you have a minute to just go check that out on Instagram, I highly recommend it. I don't want to read exactly verbatim what she wrote, and I don't want to try to paraphrase it and botch it, you know, but go ahead and read what she wrote. It's really beautiful. And I think, you know, it's sort of, as soon as I saw this post, I was like, I have to reach out. I have to ask if I can share about it because it encapsulated exactly what I wanted to share with the segment, right? Is just these stories of things that are so intimate and personal. You know, it's not something that you inherit that everybody in the world sees every day. It's just something that's in your home, or maybe something that you made that you're proud of, or, you know, I mean, there's a lot of different things, but just the way that handmade things become a part of our lives. And, you know, and then even in this case, multiple generations. So, yeah, I just love that story and wanted to share that with you. Okay, so now we're on the part of the podcast where I just talk about whatever's on my mind. So if you've made it this far, thanks for watching. And I hope you stick around to the end because I really do I want to be in conversation with you. So the first thing is just a little bit of news. I have joined the board of a creative reuse nonprofit. I'm really excited to be serving on the board of directors of an organization for the first time. And, you know, it feels like just the perfect fit for me because I'm really passionate about the environment and about creative reuse. And it also is helping me think more creatively about my own stash and just, you know, as I've been sort of immersed more in this world and in these conversations, I think I've just had more inspiration. Kind of on the on the, you know, on the same wavelength, I guess, as that, is that I'm going to be hosting a make-along in 2022 that I'm going to call the Renew and Improve Make-Along. So I think the hashtag will probably be Renew and Improve 2022 because I like the way that sounds. But this is going to be a make-along where I encourage you to take things out and that are maybe in your wardrobe or in your you know, knitting related world, such as a project bag that needs to be repaired, or you know, a whip that you need to rip out and redo part of, or even just like some jeans you want to patch, right? But this is this, there's nothing really innovative about this make along, but I just want to encourage people to find ways to put new life into things that they love or that they used to love. And whatever form that takes, just have fun with it and share that, you know? The other year-long make-along I'm gonna be doing, because I've just decided to do that, to do two. Actually, I've thought about this for a long time, and I've narrowed it down to two that I really wanna do. The next one is going to be a year of knitting with my favorite color, blue. So this will not be for everyone because not everyone wants blue, but I'm gonna make it my goal to hashtag knit blue 2022 because I found that I knit with a lot of bluish greens and bluish purples and brown with some blue flecks of tweed in it, and I haven't knit anything, especially haven't knit myself a garment that's blue in a really long time, if ever. I mean, I've done teal and turquoise, but I haven't really done blue. So, you know, as I said, I'm knitting this blue hat and I'm loving it. And I'm thinking, you know, there are so many shades of blue. Why don't I have anything midnight blue? Why don't I have anything navy blue? Why don't I have anything cobalt blue? Why don't, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So my goal is that 50% of everything I knit in the year 2022, that I knit for myself, I should say, will be in blue, which is my favorite color. So for the entire year, if you knit anything blue, you can join the knit along and be eligible for winning a prize. So I don't know what the prizes are gonna be yet, but I've got these 2 year long make-alongs, and I'm really excited to be hosting those. In the spirit of, you know, announcing things I'm going to be doing and things I'm going to be not doing, I'm not doing Vlogmas this year. I don't have the energy to do that, frankly, and I would just encourage you to watch the Vlogmases that other makers are going to be making. It's such a wonderful exercise, I guess, in video production, really, to make something every single day. Because you think, before you start podcasting, you think people just turn a camera on and talk at it. No, that's the easy part, right? There's a bunch of work that goes into it to edit it afterward. And even, you know, somebody who's doing a pretty, I guess, shoestring or, you know, simple operation like myself, I'm still doing a lot of editing. It's not a quick and easy thing. People put a lot of work into it, so I encourage you to watch their Vlogmas videos if it's someone that you follow and that you like. Yeah, only a couple more things I wanna share and talk about, and this is where I think, you know, I hope we can be in conversation. Sarah Solomon's collection for Harrisville Designs is so beautiful. If you haven't seen it, you gotta check it out. It's called Day for Night. So Harrisville Designs did this line of yarn called Nightshades, where it's like black with little flecks of color, right? So it's like a whole rainbow of black with yellow, black with green, black with blue, etc. And then they did one called Daylights, which is the same thing, but it's a natural undyed yarn with little flecks of color. I think it was only a matter of time before those yarns started to get mixed together. And of course, like, this collection is gorgeous, the way that they've presented it is super artistic, and I think represents sort of this shift that I think the knitting world is becoming more theatrical. And I think it began with Stephen West, and I think that a few other designers have sort of done this with their designs. One that I'm always watching what he's doing is Quail and Stark. And the whole like launch of the Day for Night collection is very theatrical and very evocative and beautiful. And I advise you to just go over to the Harrisville Designs Instagram and just look at what they're doing, or their website and just look at what they're doing. It's very beautiful. Yeah, big kudos to Sarah Solomon for doing this entire collection. It's amazing. I want to know what you think. How have you guys seen it? You know, have you like found the one that you're going to make? I think I've seen like three things in that collection that I'm like, oh, I'm definitely going to make that. Yeah, I'd love to know what you're thinking about that. The other thing, which I think is not such a positive story, is that there's just been a lot of information that's come to light lately about a high-profile knitting personality who doesn't treat people so well. And I guess I'm not really a person with any clout in this industry, so I can kind of say whatever I want and it doesn't cost me anything. But also, I think mostly what I want to say is that it makes me sad that people are feeling, or that there is gatekeeping, right? That it makes me sad that there's gatekeeping in this community, that people who are trying to launch a business or, get their name out there are being told that it's pay for play, and that there are just some kind of like unsavory practices going on. You should not have to pay to be interviewed, period. There may come a time when you are paid to be interviewed, but generally speaking, if somebody wants to interview you, they're already asking you for your time. You're already giving a lot by being interviewed. You should never have to pay money. And it just kind of pisses me off that people are being asked to pay money. Secondly, if you're being asked to participate in something that is a money-making venture, you should be getting paid in proportion to the work that you are doing and the interest you're ginning up and the effort that you've made. So your cost of materials should be paid for, whatever it costs you to get up and running and to do the thing, and then also your time. And that should be proportionate to how much money the event makes. So for instance, if there is an event that is charging $20 a ticket and 100 people sign up, and one of the people who's the entertainment in that is getting paid, very little money, while another person is getting the lion's share of the money, I think that's not good. And it kind of pisses me off. And the other thing is about interviews, back to that. Unless you are a political correspondent interviewing an elected official who has made a controversial decision, I don't think you should be grilling people in interviews, and I don't think you should have questions that are coming out of left field. I think you should go over the questions in advance of the interview, and you should make sure that you're asking the kind of questions that they want to answer that is going to help them generate the content that the audience wants. So if you want to hear really good interviews, I listen to Nicole Byers' Why Won't You Date Me podcast, and you can tell when she's asking questions that she has talked to the guest beforehand, and that there is if there's something they want to promote or an aspect of their career they want to talk about, that she's asking them questions about that. And I think that's just called being a good interviewer. You know, you're not grilling people and you're not surprising them with things. So people from different backgrounds have different levels of comfort with just asking to be compensated for their work. And I don't think it's wrong to ask to be compensated for your work. I think it's important to be transparent about that. Yeah, so there's sort of that element where I think some people just feel really confident asking for money, and they need to understand how off-putting that can be. But also there's a lot of, I've noticed there's not as much transparency about it. More and more I've noticed people hide the number of subscribers they have, or they hide the number of supporters they have on Patreon. And I understand not wanting to, again, like, share your income with the world if that's your primary source of income. But it is kind of, I think, important to be transparent about those things, to be transparent about what you are getting in exchange for your support. And not that I think that you should have to spell out necessarily the value of every single thing, because some of those things are intangibles. Like the value I get out of podcasts sometimes is intangible, but I think when you have a huge audience and a huge platform and you are making obviously a living, you know, it's not just pin money, I think there is a level where maybe there ought to be some transparency in that and where it's going. And especially because then I think it's important to say, like, you know, when it comes to issues of, are you asking people to pay to be interviewed? Or, you know, is that a significant and important source of your income, or is that just greediness? Or when you are hosting an event and not everyone is being compensated proportionately to what they contribute to that event, how did that decision get made? Who made it? Did everyone agree? Was that known from the get-go? And so forth. So I guess I will just leave with that. I've got nothing else to say, but I just, I would encourage you, if you are supporting podcasts, to really know what it is you are supporting, to know why. Like, what is your why? Like, if you asked me why I support the things I support on Patreon, I have an answer for every one of them. I don't need to think too hard about it, because I've already done that thinking, and that's why they get my money every month. So, leaving on that note, I hope there's some good conversation that comes out of this, and I wish you all a great week. Bye.